basically there are four things that matter to people. They have to have somewhere to live, they have to have food to eat, they have to have clothing to wear, and they have to have something to hope for. Now everything, young or old, family or otherwise, everything relates basically to this human aspiration. It may be on a higher or lower standard of living basis, but essentially this is the core of the matter.
Norman Kirk, a man who spent his life trying to get to the core of human problems. This was his distilled philosophy, a search to give other New Zealanders the certainty of having somewhere to live, food to eat, clothing to wear, and perhaps most importantly, something to hope for. Early in his life, he chose to pursue that search through the New Zealand Labour Party.
Let us remember that the New Zealand Labour Party is a New Zealand party. Not an IMF party, not a World Bank party, not a submissive party. The New Zealand Labour Party is a New Zealand party. And let us remember that the word New Zealand in our title is as important as the word Labour. We are for New Zealand. We strive for opportunities for New Zealanders in every field. We demand and will insist that New Zealanders shall have the right to run their own affairs. We're in strong opposition to everyone who demonstrates by word or action that they intend to sell New Zealand short.
It was in 1968 when Norman Kirk gave that speech. By that time, he was leader of the party. His search for the core of the matter had taken him through the ranks, had made him first an enthusiastic organizer, later one of the party's most articulate philosophers. But philosophy was not enough. He wanted power to put his principles into practice. And by the time he was elected Prime Minister in 1972, he had no self-doubts about the ripeness of the situation.
I don't feel sorry for the opposition. I worked very hard to put them where they are. And I think in any case, the objective of each member is to have been a member of Parliament, and he must accept that people govern Parliament. And it's the decision of the people, and it's accepted. And I think very largely, if you ask the opposition fellows, they'll tell you the same thing, that they accept the decision the people have made.
In November of 1972, it all seemed very clear-cut and simple. One party was out, another was in. The leader of the opposition had become the Prime Minister, and vice versa. But for all the simplicity of his public statements, Norman Kirk himself, as remembered by his chief opponent, Sir John Marshall, was a hugely complex man.
Norman Kirk was a man of many parts and many moods, a man of four seasons. In the House, when he was in full cry, he could be devastating. Yet the same speech, when you read it later, seemed unimpressive. Sometimes it didn't even make sense or logic. And that was, of course, because the personality which dominated Parliament didn't carry over into the cold print of Hansard. At other times, Norman Kirk could speak calmly and, I thought, much more convincingly in private conversation. And I talked with him many times in our roles of Prime Minister and Leader of the Opposition and vice versa. He was always quiet, courteous and reasonable, even when we disagreed, as we sometimes did. I occasionally saw him in relaxed and private surroundings. I remember when we were once in the Woolston Working Men's Club. He was very much at home there, and full of strange oaths and earthy stories. We also frequently met on social occasions over the years. It was fascinating to see the way he gradually changed from a fish out of water to the comfortable occupant of the goldfish bowl of his later years. If you compared Mr. Norman Kirk when he came into Parliament as a rather brash and unpolished young man with the Right Honourable Norman Kirk when he became Prime Minister, you would hardly recognise him as the same man. I find the same difficulty when I think of some of the harsh things he said about me in the House and on the hustings, and the generous things he said to me and of me on other occasions. The last time we met was in the lobby of the house. He had his foot in plaster and was in some pain. And it was then that he told me that he was recommending me for one of the highest orders of knighthood. That was my last and lasting memory of Norman Kirk, a man of many moods and faces.
What made Norman Kirk the complex man he was? Part of it, certainly, was the hardship of the Depression. Born in Waimate in 1923, he moved to Linwood in Christchurch as a young child. For 7 years, the total period of his life at Linwood Primary School, his cabinet-maker father was out of regular work. With his father, he often cycled out into the country to catch fish or shoot rabbits to help feed the family. At the age of only 12, he left school.
There wasn't any automatic rights of entry to high schools. It cost money for uniforms, it cost money for books. And when you live in a family where the principal preoccupation is to get enough money to pay the rent, to stay alive, there isn't any money for those sort of things. And so consequently, there wasn't really any consideration of anything else, but when you were finished primary school, finding a job as quickly as you could.
The job that Norman Kirk found was cleaning gutters around roofs for a firm of painters. He was paid 7 shillings and 6 pence for a 44-hour week. There wasn't much time for philosophy. He tried welding, he tried the railways, he worked on Auckland ferries. He married in 1943 at the age of 20, Ruth Miller, now Dame Ruth Kirk. As children arrived and a family began to grow up, living became more rather than less a struggle. He and his young family moved to Katikati, where they lived in a three-room public works hut.
Really, the principal preoccupation was how to get enough to keep things going. The family had grown a bit bigger, and you needed some more money for that. You needed some more money for clothes. Every time you seemed to go a foot ahead, you needed another 18 inches worth of money to pay for it. And if you're working scrub cutting and then you're going down doing an 8-hour stay, in theory fact, there's not a lot of time to think about things. Apart from what you're immediately engaged in. Although I had become a member of the Katikati branch of the Labour Party, a delegate to the Tauranga LRC, and we kept that branch flourishing quite actively in a district that was essentially hostile politically, and that, I mean, it's predominantly conservative.
In spite of the struggle of those years just to keep his family in decent housing, decently fed and decently clothed, Norman Kirk was able to develop the wider and deeper view of the sort of society that New Zealand could have.
You look for a type of democratic society that is going to put the rights of the individual first, is going to try and make government and parliament a tool to carry out the will of the people rather than to have parliament become the master of the people and pushing them about. You want a lively democracy, you want people who feel quite strongly about New Zealand as a country, some sort of strong sense of nationhood. You want to find some more independence and self-reliance in the country as a nation. But you also have to recognise that all these things depend on equal access to opportunities and on a recognition within the community that if society organises itself to provide basic opportunities in education, basic opportunities in employment, it also has duties towards those whose work in other years has made it possible to provide this opportunity.
That was the statement of the Norman Kirk that is easy to remember. And it isn't all that far away from the young man who, because he couldn't afford to buy concrete blocks to build his house, made them himself. He had moved to Kaipoi in Christchurch in the hope of providing better housing for his family. He found time to work 8 hours a day in a factory, to build his own home in the evenings, to take on the responsibilities of mayor of Kaipoi. In 1957, he stood for Labour against the then Minister of Finance, Harry Lake, and won the Littleton seat. His maiden speech in Parliament showed that Norman Kirk, at the age of 34, was quite convinced of the directions the Labour Party and the country should take.
The twin aims of our party are externally to work for peace and the elimination of poverty and hunger, internally to strive for a rising standard of living and lasting prosperity. Family life is the basis of society. No country enjoys a stable existence unless its policies foster and protect family life. Policies that assist the family are good. If they handicap it, they are bad. We believe that everyone who is willing to work has the right to work. We do not share the National Party's idea that the right to work should be determined by any private organisation. Yet you know, that's exactly what their proposal to abolish compulsory unionism means. When compulsory unionism goes out, preference to unionists and the closed shop comes in. Of course, the National Party may not mean to keep this promise. They didn't keep it before when they had the chance. Let's see they don't get the chance again.
A maiden speech. But already there were signs of the qualities that were to take Norman Kirk to the leadership of the party in December 1965.
Well, I'm extremely proud to have the honour of being elected by my colleagues in caucus to this very important office. And I'm very mindful, too, that I've been elected to an office that has been held by a series of distinguished people. And it is a great honour indeed to have been given the confidence of the caucus in this way.
Did you expect to win by such a substantial majority?
I expected to be nominated. I expected there to be a ballot. Thereafter, I've long since learned in elections that you can predict results best after the ballot is returned.
The next ballot for Norman Kirk wasn't so favourable. The party was clearly beaten by National in 1966. His best friends say that Norman went through long periods of self-doubt in the next 2 years. But by 1969, he'd regained his self-confidence, and the people of New Zealand began to realise what the Labour Party had known for years, that Norman Kirk was a man who could make things happen.
We've a country that's old enough to have a past to turn to, yet young enough to have a future we ourselves can make. Round the corner of the 70s, a new decade to understand the part that every one of us must undertake. Make things happen this year.
It's your turn now to make things happen. For your future, the future of all New Zealand. This November, give your vote to Labour.
But even when political success was obviously on the way, Norman Kirk was still something of a paradox. A man with a common touch, a man of the people, but a man who was always alone. It was a paradox that was to persist after he became Prime Minister.
The sort of hours we work, and the fact that it is 7 days a week for the most part, it's only on rare occasions there's anything like you'd call spare time, means that your contact with friends is limited, and unhappily limited most times to those occasions when they happen to be present at something that you're involved in. You see, if you're getting home 11, half past 11 or midnight, you're not going to have many friends to sit down and talk to.
Is it a lonely job?
Yes. Yes, that it is, because you're on your own a great deal in everything. You may talk to everybody, you can get facts, you can discuss problems, but in the ultimate, if it's come to you, this is the last place it can go to, and you have to make that decision.
Lonely, alone in his decision-making, but at the same time almost compulsively garrulous, a man who needed to recharge his energies talking to people. One of his best friends in the long years in opposition was Arthur Faulkner.
For years, whenever the House rose at 5:30 p.m. for the dinner adjournment, we used to go and walk the full length of the Wellington waterfront and arrive back in the House just about 10 to 7 or around about that time, night after night. In those days, the waterside workers were working a night shift, or at least an evening shift, and we would walk around amongst them while they were working there, and we were not public figures or well known at that time, both being tall men and normally dressed in dark lounge suits, I'm sure at times that the waterside workers thought we were either insurance agents, perhaps even detectives, but certainly not watersiders. I remember on a couple of occasions a couple of the waterside workers saying, "Well, who are you?" Perhaps not quite as politely as that, but that was their intention. And I can see now how Norman would proudly go into his hip pocket, pull out his wallet, and produce his Littleton Waterside Workers Union ticket, because he had, I think, been an honorary member of it for many years and always kept it current. And to see now the look on the faces of those waterside workers, to find among them someone who'd worked very hard for the Littleton Waterside Workers Union to the point where that he was recognised as an honorary member by them, used to, of course, be open sesame to anything that we wanted to do or say to the people on the job.
The people on the job were the first he paid tribute to on the night in 1972 when he first became Prime Minister. When the message was broadcast internationally that New Zealand had a new government, this is what BBC listeners in London heard him say.
"I think tonight you could describe this as a victory for the little people of the country, the average families, the people who work in the factories and the farms, the manufacturers, a lot of the small farmers, the people who are inclined always to be overlooked, have been seriously concerned about the erosion of family life, the drift of the community towards a sort of wanton materialism, I think you could say. And what this really represents is the average man in New Zealand saying, enough, it's time we came back on course."
Norman Kirk himself explained his sweeping election victory simply. He'd followed through on the principles that had governed his political life.
"I think to be effective, truly effective, means being close to the people. And in this election campaign, I suppose I could say that I'd been effective, and the results suggest that we have been. Mostly, I think, that was due to the fact that we took our election campaign to the people, and we went into the small towns, sometimes to villages where there were only six or seven people turned up. We went to Naseby, for example, where we had one half of the total voting population, 17 people. But they are as important as the 2,200 that you meet in Auckland, and we really went back to the people."
His choice of a campaign style was not simply a matter of politics. It was part of the whole philosophy of the man.
"Democracy doesn't belong to government or the prime ministers, it belongs to the people. We have a House of Representatives, and if it's going to represent the people, it needs to know what they're thinking, and the best place to find that out is from the people themselves. You can't determine it with public opinion polls or from political science theories or anything like that. You've got to go back and talk to the people and be available to them. And I think the healthiest and strongest feature of New Zealand political life is the relative availability of the people in politics to the people of the electorate."
In the months immediately following his election as Prime Minister, Norman Kirk had the new experience of being followed by flunkies, surrounded by speechwriters. But he was never buried by them. His real powers of oratory shone through when he spoke without notes to ordinary New Zealanders of all races. At Waitangi Day ceremonies in February of 1973, Mr. Kirk made one of the great speeches of his life. And he made the spirit of Waitangi come alive by a simple action which most New Zealanders watching television that night will not forget. The Prime Minister, a massive man, quite casually took the hand of a small Maori boy, and the two walked slowly across the marae, hand in hand. This was Norman Kirk's vision of what New Zealand should be, what it could be. Not for the first time in his life, Norman Kirk was leading from way out front.
"We have come to Waitangi to mark an occasion that founded a nation. And it founded a nation in a way that was unique. At that time, the great countries of the world were scrambling for overseas possessions, which they seized without regard to the wishes or the interests of the occupants of those lands. Hobson's visit to New Zealand was unique because he was under instruction that the annexation of New Zealand was not to be attempted without the consent of the occupants of that country. And indeed, it was because of those instructions that the treaty came into being. There is a tendency to think of this as a monumental milestone in the history of the Maori people. But Waitangi is not just for the Maori or for Northland, it is for New Zealand. And we want to remember that those of us whose ancestors came from across the sea benefited from that agreement. Countries that no longer held opportunity for the pioneers were left behind, and they came to a country of scope and opportunity, and there set down their roots in a bicultural community. And tonight, we mark the gift of opportunity that was given to all peoples of New Zealand by the wisdom and agreement of those who stood on this spot 133 years ago. This day will become New Zealand's Day and will be recognised as such, and next year, on the 6th of February, legislation will be in existence that marks this day as New Zealand's Day, New Zealand's National Day, and it will be a holiday in commemoration of that act for all New Zealand. The Treaty of Waitangi has stood for 133 years. The status and dignity of that agreement should and will be recognised by Parliament in a form that signifies and symbolises the importance of that treaty to every New Zealander. And tonight, I want to say that we weld together in New Zealand, not a society which demands that some give up their identity in the interests of a majority, but that we each can preserve our culture and our identity and concentrate on building a society in which we have equal opportunity to participate in the benefits and responsibilities of New Zealand. Let Waitangi Day be both a memorial and a milestone, and let us remember that the future that we as a country build for ourselves is a future we must hasten to busy ourselves with, because the generation my young friend represents cannot wait too long to seize the opportunities that we must create. This is our nation, our opportunity to foster and encourage New Zealand's nationhood, and we mark with pride and gratitude what has been, and resolve that for the future together we work to build the society in New Zealand that gratifies us and becomes the envy of others.
Early 1973, Norman Kirk was riding high, the peak of his career, the height of his powers. It seemed only natural that at this time he should be a guest on the celebrity show of jet-setter David Frost.
What's the quality that you most admire about Mr. Marshall?
His quietness.
Is he the most formidable opponent as leader of the opposition that you could have?
No. Sir Keith Holyoake would have been, I think. And I would have liked to have beaten him at the election. He beat me twice.
And then he cheated.
But he is a... Well...
Getting out.
It's hard to tell whether the rug was pushed or dragged. But he was a good politician. He was a good fighter. And I would have liked to have beaten him. And he still is a pretty acute tactician.
Would you say that there's anyone else up and coming who would be a strong opponent in the other party?
Not in Parliament, no. This is one of the problems. Please don't think I'm unhappy about it. But one result of the election was that they lost all promising material. The people they've retained don't really have that sort of promise.
Why is that? Because in swing seats is where the younger talent usually is?
No, I think to lead a party there are some special characteristics called for, and some of the people they had that had those talents lost their seats, and lost them not so much because of their individual activities but because the swing was widespread. I don't think people in New Zealand will vote for a leader that they're afraid of or that's a bit erratic, who always seems to bind all the world out of step but himself. The people who have won election as prime ministers over a long period of years have been common sense and I suppose safe people, you could say, the sort of people who are not going to rush off into some wild adventure or perhaps take up too domineering or harsh attitude towards people.
But there were still regrets, still some things that didn't change.
You don't get too much time home, but then I didn't before. But now I'm home each day, and so you're about more often, but while the house is sitting, you'd be very lucky if you were home much before midnight. And I get in here this morning, it was about 7:30. Most days, around 7:30, 8 o'clock.
You drive yourself in?
Oh, yeah. Why not? I can drive. A lot of other people drive themselves to work. Can't see why not.
In fact, the trappings of power embarrassed him. Once in a while, Norman Kirk would talk about the things he didn't like about the job.
I think the dignity of the office can be upheld without a lot of the sort of sirring procedures that are involved.
What procedures?
The sirring procedures. It always struck me as off-key that people I'd known for a long time, I'd worked with in opposition, knew my name when I was in opposition and thought it had been changed to Sir the day I was elected. They were showing respect, I guess, but respect isn't a matter of the words that are used. The office is important, the responsibilities are important, no question about that, but surely that doesn't set you aside from the human race.
Somewhat to the concern of the system, the man who built his own house concrete block by concrete block wanted to maintain this do-it-yourself attitude to the highest office in the land. Perhaps too much so.
It means that the volume of work handled increases, but that also poses its special problems because I've always liked to know what's going on. I've always liked to be in the position of somebody who says, well, what's happening about so-and-so, to be able to tell them. If someone else does it, of course, you don't know. And so consequently, you have to adjust yourself to that sort of situation.
What about
but
the
I make it my business still to know a fair bit.
You still make your own phone calls?
Some.
The other...
Why not? You know, if you reckon it up, if I buzz somebody and say, get me so-and-so on the phone,
Well, there's that much time. There's the time he uses getting them on the phone, the time he tells me that they're on the phone. It's a lot quicker just to go straight through.
But politics is not always a matter of finding quick solutions by means of a telephone call. Sometimes politicians can paint themselves into a corner in opposition and find, in government, that the only way out is politically embarrassing. That was very much so for Mr. Kirk on the 10th of April, 1973, when he announced the postponement of the Springbok rugby tour of New Zealand, a postponement he had promised not to force.
On the Springbok issue, I found myself in a position where the evidence that was being placed before me as to what would happen if the tour went ahead, as opposed to what had been said last year, when this evidence was kept from our knowledge by the then government, produced a substantial conflict so far as I was personally concerned. But in the final analysis, what do I do as Prime Minister? Accept the embarrassment and do what I believe I was elected to do, make the proper decisions in the interest of the country, or run away from what I should do in order not to be embarrassed politically.
The cancellation of the Springbok rugby tour was a classic example of a politician caught between what he knew was right and what he knew was popular. He must have sadly regretted ever having said he would not intervene to stop the tour. He always seemed a little uncomfortable arguing the matter on the basis of law and order in New Zealand, and it was with some relief, several months later, that he could report that most New Zealanders seemed to accept the moral basis for the decision.
I thought that race relations had hardened in New Zealand, and I think the reporting of race riots in America, troubles in Nigeria, things like that, left a lot of people feeling that somehow or other coloured people were being ungrateful. The European here enjoys a good living standard. He would be anxious to see that other people have it, but I don't think he really understands the position that a great many people found themselves in. When he saw these things happening, he saw only the mischief, but not the cause. And I believe that was reflected in New Zealand for a time in a hardening of attitudes. But I also believe that most New Zealanders are pretty common sense people, and they turn it over for themselves, and they've come back on course. And I think the most interesting thing about the postponement of the Springbok tour last year was the letters that came, hundreds of them, couched in terms that implied the person themselves had made a decision. And a great many of them said, well, you know, I think we've done the right thing. And it was like returning to a policy that somehow or other they'd strayed from.
Perhaps it was this sense of being supported by a nation of people who genuinely wanted to get rid of race prejudice that made Norman Kirk one of the few Pākehās who was totally at home on the marae. Unschooled, working class in origin, he nevertheless had the natural dignity, the manner, that demonstrated on the marae that he was a man born to lead. His first speech as Prime Minister on a marae was to a Rotorua Polynesian festival.
We have seen in the last quarter of a century the Maori people transform from a community that lived largely in the country, in communal conditions, transforming slowly to becoming an urban society, until today almost three people in every four of the Maori race live in urban societies in New Zealand. And so to them great changes have come. Ought we not to think of a canoe setting out from a harbour on a new journey to a new harbour? Before it can leave, before it can determine the direction it ought to go, it needs to know where it is, it needs to know what it has done, and where it has been. Because where it has been and what it has done, it's the basis of the experience that determines what they need to take with them and how they need to prepare for the journey. The new direction that has to be travelled in order to arrive at the goal that is set can only be achieved if you know where you are and in what direction you want to travel. Today's festival is like that harbour and the people like the canoe. They are setting out on a new journey in a new direction in a new society. And to be able to know the direction to travel, to be able to know how to prepare for that journey, to be able to establish what they will do, they need to draw from what they have been and what they have done and what they understand, so that the revival of Maori culture is not just entertainment, but it is a renewal of spirit, it is a re-establishment of experience, which arms and fits and guides each individual person in the new journey they are making from the old rural society to the new urban society. So that Maori culture, as expressed here at this festival, is not only a joyful thing, it is an immensely serious thing which will provide the guidelines for the new society that Maori and European are creating in New Zealand.
Norman's understanding of New Zealand's multicultural society was a springboard to an understanding of other races in other parts of the world. Other politicians talk about it, but he believed in the brotherhood of men. He had a vision of New Zealand that included the whole Pacific region. He recognized the interdependence of cultures and people.
There is a cynicism about aid, and sometimes because the world stubbornly refuses to reform itself overnight, because poverty refuses to go away when we think it ought to, when the first involvement doesn't provide the final solution, there is a public tendency to say, oh, they're ungrateful, they're not doing what they ought to do like we do. But any sort of excuse to pretend that the responsibility for being poor rests on the poor rather than on the rich. And the need to see clearly that whether we like it or not, by the power of man's intellect, we've succeeded in converting the world from a series of unrelated states into a very closely interconnected spaceship where events in any one part of the world inevitably reach out and affect the rest of us in every other part of the world. And survival, justice, peace, are things that are the responsibility of each and every one of us.
There was a lot more to his philosophy on foreign aid than sentimental compassion. Unschooled he was, uneducated he was not. He had a genuine sense of history and a tough-minded realism.
We are inclined to look on periods of war as an unnatural state of affairs to be terminated as quickly as possible, and thereupon we will return to peace, and peace is the natural state of affairs. I want to remind you that we are the descendants of primitive people for whom violence was the natural state of affairs and who slowly evolved a system of law and order, slowly evolved a system which equated the rights of the weak with the rights of the strong through the use of the intelligence the human race has been given. And indeed, peace is the unnatural state of affairs, and war or violence, the natural. Peace has been man-created. And thus, when we think in terms of war and peace, and we talk of the hunger of the world for peace, we see at once that peace can only be achieved by constant and positive policies directed at justice for people, justice between people, and justice between countries.
He could be flamboyant in his pursuit of justice between countries. His rhetoric and his actions, such as the sending of a frigate to Mururoa to protest against French nuclear explosions, made great headlines. But the sending of a frigate to the bomb test zone was more than just a publicity gimmick. It was a deliberate and calculated political act, toughly reasoned and carried through without brinkmanship.
It is a matter that the country and its people are totally opposed to the continuation of tests. They're totally opposed to the contamination of the atmosphere, and we would use a naval vessel to represent at the place of the test the strong objections of our country to their continuance. That's never been done before. It's an effective way of demonstrating officially at the place where it's happening how you feel about it. But we're not going to sail a boat in right under the bomb. But we can be close enough to be effective and to demonstrate how we feel about it.
At home and abroad, Norman Kirk was now becoming a political giant. It was only logical that he should reach the top of the pot charts as well. Norm, the man of social credit is now. Big Norm was big at international conferences, too. Lee Kuan Yew, Prime Minister of Singapore and a personal friend, remembers the impression he made at the Commonwealth Prime Minister's Conference in Ottawa.
I saw him for 8 days in conference in Ottawa in August of 73, and there were a great number of more eloquent, more voluble, if you like, people. He wasn't eloquent in that way, that he could string words in an elegant and alliterative and say things just pat. But what came through at the end of 8 days was the honesty of the man, the sincerity with which he held his convictions, and that you could rely on what he said to you as his real position.
But always, Norman was as comfortable with the old, the ordinary, as he was with the ambitious and the powerful. There's as much importance about the reminiscences of 90-year-old Isabella McGillicutt of Central Otago as there is in the memories of the important men of the world.
When he was here, I said to him, my niece and nephew are going to put a big birthday party on for me when I'm 90. Before I had time to ask him, would he come? He said, but Mrs. Kirk and I'll come to it. You see, so I tell people that's one promise he did keep. He came to my birthday.
The talkback radio phenomenon coincided with the rise of Norman Kirk. He relished the freedom the talkback radio gave, the instant contact with ordinary New Zealanders. Once, on a Christchurch radio talkback show, an old man phoned the Prime Minister to complain that the elderly were not getting enough in their pensions. The talkback host tried to apologise for the criticism.
I don't object to him wanting more. Why shouldn't he? Everybody else wants more. And we should never forget that everything that we enjoy is founded on the work of people that went before us. And the elderly folk in the community, through their work, whether they were mothers who raised families or whether they were people who worked in industry or on farms or wherever they were, they helped build what we're enjoying, and they're entitled to a share of it.
Norman Kirk was a guest on that show during a remission in his final illness. His voice was already beginning to show the strain of ill health. A few weeks later, obviously sick, He attended the 1974 Labour Party annual conference. The scenes of loyalty and devotion at that conference were something totally new to post-war New Zealand politics. Norman could only walk slowly with the aid of a stick. When he rose to speak, his audience was completely captured. The vision he showed in that speech, which he might have known was his last to the Labour Party as a whole, was beyond the immediate. His imagination took in the grand swing of world affairs. He forced that conference to share his vision.
I wonder whether, yet, New Zealanders, and indeed the rank and file of our own party, understand the nature of the changes that have come over the world. Dayton means that the United States and the Soviet Union, in amicable agreement, are going to try and impose their will on the world. Much better than doing it militarily, and I welcome the improvement. But in the Middle East, small countries have shown that they too have power and influence, sometimes because of their strategic position, sometimes because of the raw materials they possess or the resources. They are able to impose their will. Without dealing with the Middle East situation any length at all, let me make several points. First, what has happened in the Middle East has shaken the capitalist system to its very roots. And the fight internationally for the next 2 to 3 years will not be to balance the oil crisis, but to prevent the whole structure collapsing in a Great Depression. We need to see that clearly and prepare our defences. We also need to see that when you have money, the salesman knocks on the door. And we should be vigilant in the United Nations and elsewhere to see that the salesman that knocks on the Middle East door is not the fellow who sells the guns, but the man who sells the means for an improved life for the people in those countries. Because if it is arms that are sold, the fuse of the bomb has been lit.
That fuse is still burning. It's been left to other men to ensure that New Zealand is not caught in the explosion. Bill Rowling.
The one thing that hasn't changed and won't change with the change of leadership are the key policies that were instituted when Norman Kirk was the leader of the party. And really this continuity is shown through. I think there were many people expected with Norman's death that the party might disintegrate. Certainly there would be a considerable amount of fragmentation. And if there had been, in my view, any significant changes in policy, this would have happened. But the policies that he was so ably putting before the people were the policies of the party. And it's the policies which, of course, give the party real strength and bind the party very closely together. And so the tragedy of his death, in some ways, really cemented the people of the party in a determination to ensure that the path in which he directed us should be followed in the future. And far from being fragmented as a result of his loss, we were brought together with an even greater determination to see them through during the balance of this term and in the future terms that the government has.
How do you measure a man? In the final analysis, you can only judge him in his own terms, by reckoning how well a man succeeded in the things he himself set out to do. As Norman would have said, that is the core of the matter.
There are some people who like to be remembered, there are others who are never forgotten, and it's better to be remembered than never forgotten. But I guess the most that anyone hopes for is to be remembered for having done a reasonably good and honest job. And inside the field of politics, this means that as far as the country is concerned, it represents a period of pretty solid progress.
And if there is one thing more than anything else that I would be keen to see and would like to think that I had contributed in a worthwhile way to, would be to cultivate in New Zealand a strong, self-reliant sense of nationhood, to try and get away from this dependent mentality that we acquired in the days of colonialism and which we haven't completely shed yet. We still browbeat ourselves with the idea that we're a small country and there are great limitations on what we can do. But I think we ought to remember that ideas have force rather than size. And it's what we aim to do and what we try to do together leads us to a position where New Zealand becomes quite a sturdy, self-reliant, independent country, and a strong sense of nationhood is acquired in the process. Then anybody, I think, would be very satisfied to be remembered as having had a part in that.